Michelle, it's great to have you here today. Thank you for being on Best Mom Products.
Thank you so much for having me. It's a huge opportunity.
Good, good. Well, we're glad to have you. And I wanted to talk to you a little bit about how you came up with the idea, and we can start from there. And maybe you can describe your product a little bit more.
Boulder Kids crafts functional outdoor gears for babies. So we're really focused on carried or harnessed babies and making sure that they are protected from the weather and the elements in ecological softshell material that I source here in Switzerland. And so I really only have three products. It's a small collection, and I've called it the Go Farther Performance Infant Carrier Collection. It's really a mouthful. But these three products, one is an extra long mitten that locks into place so that it doesn't fall off when babies are moving about and they can't really yank it off, so you're convinced that their hands will be warm. It's a boot cover product, so it's an overshoe or instead of a shoe when your baby is older. And again, it locks in place with a rip stop cord. And then the showcase product and the product we've won some awards for is an infant carrier cover, which works universally on a number of carriers like Baby Bjorn, Ergo Baby, sling models that parents might prefer. And this has pockets for you and pockets for the baby. And there's a nice video on the website that can showcase it a little bit more than we can do here.
Great, and I'll put a link to the website too so people can go and check that out. Can you talk a little bit about, you're an outdoorsy mom, you're an athlete. Can you talk about how you came up with the idea and what did you look for on the market and how did you decide that this was the product that you wanted to go with?
I mean, the idea for Boulder Kids and these specific products came out of my need. I was living in Switzerland when my children were born in Zurich, and I was using the train to get from my apartment into the city, and managing public transportation with a stroller was just awkward. There are steps and things you had to do. And so I would bundle my child up in a snowsuit, put him in a carrier cover, and within 10 minutes of walking out the door, he'd fall asleep. And that was lovely. But then, as soon as I got on the train, I would need to acclimatize him correctly for the weather. And so I'd undo the carrier, undo the snowsuit, open him up. Of course, invariably, he would wake up. And then repeat process every time I'm going in and out of a shop or something like this. Carrying babies just seemed to make sense, not for any major ethos, just for practical purposes. And I really needed a way to shelter them from the weather that I could easily remove and drop, and that was packable and portable, and so that I didn't need to carry a diaper bag and my purse and really feel weighted down. I wanted lightweight solutions. So the need was born when my children were born, basically. And so it took me some time then to create the company, but that's where the inspiration came from.
How much have you invested to date, would you say, in your product, in your business?
Well, I'll tell you about the launch capital just because it's easier. The launch capital was 30,000 Swiss francs. And of that, more than two-thirds of it was spent on the very first run of the material. So it's quite pricey to launch a product-based company versus a services company. The key cost associated with manufacturing a textile product is your material, right? I mean, if you're going to produce something in the highest quality silk, or in my case, the highest quality performance gear, you're going to pay a premium for that raw good, and you don't want to throw it out. And the second highest cost, I would say, is your sewing time. And literally, that means every line sewn is measured. What I liked so much when I went out to the factory, and why I think it's so important to go, is you can really see that the jobs that are meant to go fast, and the jobs that are meant to go slow, something that takes a full minute to do well, do right the first time. Like, for example, I think it's really important that the rip cords in my mittens, these drawstring rip cords, that they're sewn in place so that they're not a choking hazard. That's a quality check. And it's something that should take a second longer for, and I'm very happy to pay for it to take that second longer for. Those jobs need to be done carefully.
And so let me ask you, as a small business owner, then, what was the minimum run that you were able to do?
And I think a lot of people get scared or potentially always look to the Far East or to some other location because they're thinking that their costs are going to be low or something like this. We were able to secure 200 square meters of material and make 160 products times three. So all three products were made from 200 square meters of material, which means my waste was extremely minimal. And it's one of the reasons, in fact, why I decided to go on ahead and produce small mittens and booties. They're not small. In fact, they work in one size from 3 to 18 months, which is part of the EcoVision, was to have a long life product. Mm-hmm. But the pieces to make those products on a baby hand are small.
Right.
And by small pieces, we make maximum utilization of our very expensive raw good material.
You know, is there any question that you wish you would have asked the manufacturing group that you didn't? Or did they provide anything to you that you were surprised with that you wish you would have known?
I would say two things. One, in the prototyping process, don't go get 10 or 20 or 200 prototypes. Get one, because you'll be blown away by what you think is clearly understood that really wasn't. Even if you've agreed on it, even if it's drawn on, even if you're shown something exactly like it, when they go and produce the prototype, something on the factory floor can go wrong. And so if you're paying for those prototypes, just get the one, even if it means a few extra weeks in your prototyping phase. I would say that, number one, in terms of cost savings. Number two, I think it's very important to make sure that you really fully understand the capabilities and the quality that your manufacturer is able to produce, for example, and the innovation. Manufacturers are really about solving problems. If your zipper is 1 millimeter in the wrong size, it may not fit in their machines. And so you want to work with suppliers that they've already worked with. You want to really understand what they're capable of, what's new that they might want to try in terms of their manufacturing processes that they might cut you a break on because they want to try this new process, and it might show a great innovation in your material or your ultimate end product. And finally, don't hesitate. It's not to get quotes around the block. It's really make sure you see what they can do. I think that's really, really key. If you've got somebody who's working with parachute material, that's not soft shell. If you've got somebody working with soft shell, that's not Gore-Tex or raw goods and the gluing processes and stuff. And then go. I really think it's invaluable to let them take you to lunch. You're the client. You get taken for lunch. It's not you taking them for lunch. And shake hands with everybody present so that they really know who this new brand is, that you're proud enough and responsible enough on your side to go and meet them and ensure the quality, both at the design phase, I would say, because that's where you learn what they're capable of, and later at the production phase when you want to ensure the quality is present.
Okay.
And ask them, I would say one more question to ask, is make sure that if you're using labels, for example, from your supplier, your material supplier, if you were to choose Gore-Tex, for example, you'd need to be a Gore-Tex partner. You'd need to have a Gore-Tex label on that jacket someplace. Make sure that the glues on that particular label stick to your jacket, that they don't peel off, because it ends up being your responsibility to replace that or repair that later on. And I'm proud to say that we've never had a product come back for any reason. And I think that has to do with making sure that these questions up front are asked and assured by your manufacturing partner.
You're self-funded. So why did you choose to go at this alone rather than have a co-founder?
I truly didn't even consider getting a partner or going at it with a team, even though I knew the chances for success were really slim without a partner or without a team. I know my limitations. I have many. We all do. But I also knew my strengths, and I thought that I really, before anybody, and I guess I just assumed that before anybody would invest in me, so going out for investing partners, for example, that I needed to get some entrepreneurial fortitude. And since these were new industries for me, going into the baby industry, I don't come from this industry, going into the outdoor sporting goods industry at the time, I wasn't even sure that there was a difference between sports and outdoor sports, and there is a clear delineation between the two. I really just needed to go and get my feet wet, I think. I needed to learn the industries and try. And when I looked at the cost of setting up a website and the cost of doing any market research, it just made sense to take a little bit of capital, put it at trying and getting started and getting some real feedback to see if that would be sufficient, and then build a team later. I would say it's a good choice for getting started, but for me, a team player and who's always been part of a team, it's really been difficult. I think it's hard to motivate yourself every day. It's hard to do the things you know you should do without being accountable to somebody else or accountable to, even to your own vision and to propel yourself forward in the hard times, and just to share also the successes. The successes are a little bit muted when you share them alone. So I think it's time. It's time to find a partner. It's time to move faster. And I think I can do that better with a team.
We talked about manufacturing. Maybe we can go into a little bit now about marketing, kind of how I like to divide the interviews. So with marketing, you know, there's so much we can talk about here. One, I want to talk a little bit about your actual product and what you've learned from retailers. I think I wrote down, you're kind of in between, like you found out a baby industry and an outdoors market. So how did you discover that and where do you go from there?
I think I discovered it before launching the company. I mean, I think I was aware that I was maybe 5 years ahead of schedule. My children, I was not finding what I was looking for my children. And basically, when you go to the outdoor shops as a consumer, at the time that I was going, my oldest is now 9 years old. At the time that I was going, I really felt as though products didn't start until they were about 8 or 9 years old. You know, 8 and up is when the good products came to market for kids. In building Boulder Kids, I can see that this timeline is coming down. It's now about 2 or 4 years where you can see some really impressive brands launching really expensive products. Cuse and Peak Performance and some really big labels at high price points are launched now for babies, and the quality is there too. Not babies, but toddlers and young children. But for babies, there was really nothing. You had to go to baby stores to find baby-related products. And the baby stores and the baby industry in general, I think, looks for very high volume, very low price, very high margin on the retail side. And they don't really understand or care about, it's not that they don't care about an eco label. They're just a little bit more older school, I would say. Whereas if you go into an outdoor shop, you really find very knowledgeable staff. They're very passionate about their sports and things. And they want to, in their window, they really want to show that they cater to all members of the family. They like to have these jogging strollers or Chariot, for example, in Canada produces a wonderful sleigh system that turns into a jogging stroller that turns into a, you know, this, that, and the other thing. I mean, it's very, very high-end products on the hardware side, but very little on the soft, protect your baby, fit well textile side.
Okay, so where do you go from there? So you're launching a product, you know that you're in the middle. If you're in the middle, then it's going to be hard to sell to retailers, right, on either side. There's a great deal of education, and you've discovered these things before, but you still went ahead and did it. So can you tell, very passionate about your product, and there's definitely, you know, a need, obviously, but can you talk about that?
So I went the retail site because everybody said you're not a credible brand if you don't build a high prestige in big fancy shops. And so going to the baby boutiques that were gorgeous and going to the outdoor shops that had this knowledgeable staff, this was the vision. Also because it gives your brand some prestige, right? If you're in Chamonix, if you're in Verbier, if you're in these great locations here in Switzerland anyway, it'd be like being in Vail, Colorado, or something like this in North America. This adds some prestige to your brand, for sure. The challenge that I discovered going retail is retailers in general are order takers. They really want a t-shirt to fly off of the shelves. They really want a simple product, something that is simply explained, that explains itself, and that sells and moves really quickly. This is where the baby shops are quite different. Baby shop retailers are quite interested in showing you exactly how that stroller breaks down and how to collapse the bed and do these things. But they don't understand technical performance materials and don't really have that outdoorsy clientele often. And so I went to the retailers and I tried this strategy. I sold to the retailers, but they didn't sell through very well at all, I would say. And this was a problem, of course. It really ruined my confidence to go back out to retailers because if the story isn't good, if they're not selling, I felt I had an ethical problem actually. And so I stopped. I stopped going out to retailers and I said, okay, let me go direct. And I started hosting mom walks and doing some direct PR and getting some really great press in the Huffington Post and in Germany's largest circulated paper, the Süddeutsche Zeitung. I say that wrong, actually, it's the Zeitung.
I have a feeling most people would not know the difference. But thank you
My
for
German is bad. But it was a wonderful father that reviewed us there. A new father that one of the comments he made about the gear was that he's no longer lambasted by women in the checkout aisle because of which carrier he uses, that the gear actually covers the carrier too. And so he could it simplified his life for him in this way that I never anticipated. So I think going direct ultimately gives me, it's a slower approach for me, in large part because I don't have a marketing partner who knows how to do this stuff very effectively. But it allows me to completely control the sales process and the user experience and to show parents how to fit the gear so that their children are warm in winter, and how to use it long life and how to layer effectively. And so I really get this one-on-one experience, which I believe over time will be very, very good for the brand. It is good for the brand. I can see this today.
So, can you talk a little bit about what kind of marketing that you do? And you had mentioned when we had talked before that you learned, and you just talked about it, that over 60% of your customers are dads. So, are you marketing directly to dads?
I'm really not. I'm really not. I mean, I really don't know how I would have to say to approach it correctly, and maybe that is one of the reasons for a call like this. And I hope somebody out there is listening. But dads like gear, and I've known this before. Dads like simplicity, and they really like gear. And if they are passionate about their outdoor sports, and they're certainly passionate about their infant children, and they have tremendous protective instincts to shield those babies. Moms often have difficulty with their backs after a pregnancy, so dads are often the ones carrying anyway. Even though they are not reading the literature that moms read, moms don't read labels on the hang tags themselves on the outdoor garments. They kind of touch with their fingers and say, "Ooh, this is soft enough for my baby," or, "Oh, I love that color." Whereas dads say, "This will perform. This will protect my child. This will give me a long day out without a screaming baby." And I think that story is very interesting for fathers. And so we do have guides, we do have professional sailors, and we do have just ordinary Joes who are city types who are walking around by a lake where it's windy, or by a beach, or along a riverside. And on that Sunday walk, they just want to have an easy walk. Our kit is gray, it's anthracite colored gray. And it works universally for dads too, and it simplifies things.
You said you were mentioned in the Huffington Post and other outlets. What did that do? Did that do? Did you see any sales from that?
All of the sales that are produced in Germany, which are actually, I'd say, are the lion's share of sales apart from, say, Switzerland, which is where I live nearest to. All of the sales are from that Süddeutsche Zeitung Post, which
Okay.
was on the front of a section called Mobile Living. Directly translated, it's called Mobile Living. So it's a major page in and among their pages, akin to the New York Times and a Mobile Living section front page.
What traits do you think make an entrepreneur?
I think Guy Kawasaki said it best. He said, "You really need to know how to sell something." That's very, very important. I think you need to know how to sell something, and whether it's air or the force of your own character and personality, or a solution sell, or a product, you need to know how to sell.
I think our listeners and viewers will definitely love this interview. So, thank you so much for being here, Michelle.
Thank you so much for the time and for being willing to entertain somebody who sits in Europe but who's an American and loving to just speak American English for a while.